Hey folks, welcome back to the Rupedia world, and I am Abhinay Gupta. And today again we are continuing with the standards on auditing, and the standard under consideration for today's lecture would be SA620, which is using the work of an auditor's expert, right? And remember, this is not the first lecture for this topic, for this standards on auditing. We have already had a lecture which was actually very important. Why? Because in the standard of using the work of an auditor's expert, we dealt with the definition and the meaning of auditor's expert in the previous lecture itself. So not much remains for you in this lecture other than the requirement of the standard. Right? So if you have missed on to that lecture, please go back, read it, listen to it, view it, understand it, and then come and start this lecture from here. Right? So now we would move ahead and see the lecture for the day, right? So what have we covered so far? The scope and objective, which is the non-applicability, the responsibility and the objective, right? Apart from that, we had started the definition and we had already dealt with the definition of the auditor's expert, right? Are you people absolutely sure about the definition? Now, are you actually capable of deciding who would be considered as an auditor's expert and who would not, right? Think in your mind, how many of you actually think that yes, you can, and how many of you think you can't? I'll give you certain cases now and decide whether or not he will be an auditor's expert, or who among the two will be an auditor's expert and who will be a normal internal auditor's expert, auditor's internal expert. So now consider a situation. What we always say is that the auditor's expert is supposed to be somebody apart from the field of accountancy and auditing, right? Two fields. Now the example is, like, if you're talking about expertise and if we deal with taxation matter, then yes, you know that, okay, if we are talking about the taxation law and stuff, it is an auditor's expert, but that is not my question. My question is specific. Now what is the matter? Number one, you are actually appointing an expert for applying the method of accounting for the deferred income tax, right? Because you do not know the deferred income tax very well, so you are appointing an expert who would actually go ahead with the accounting of the deferred income tax, right? Is he an external expert or is he an internal expert? Will he be considered to be an auditor's expert for the purpose of this standard? That is my simple question over here. And the answer to it is again a very simple no. Why? Because although we are dealing with the deferred taxation matter, right? But it is not a matter of dealing with how to calculate the deferred tax. No. It is not a matter of dealing with how to carry forward the deferred tax. No. It's not a matter of dealing with whether or not it will be considered, whether or not there is an occurrence of deferred tax. No. It is a matter of, yes, if you know the deferred tax, how do you apply your accounting methods for recognition of that deferred tax? That is the basic question. Are you capable enough, or have you appointed an auditor? What the expert is doing is applying the method of accounting for deferred income tax. So he is not an auditor's expert, external expert. He will not be covered under this standard, right? But on the other hand, if you have expert on taxation law, that I don't know the applicability of this taxation law, let me know the applicability, I'll tell you how to incorporate it into the financials. That will be the task of the auditor's internal experts. But what is to be included? What is happening? What is the taxation law? That is the part of the auditor's external expert. I hope the example was helpful for you. Clear with the concept that just tax does not always say that it is an auditor's expert job. What are you doing with the tax is actually what is relevant. What you see, what you have in hand is not that relevant, but what you can have and what you can forecast is what is important. Now, similarly, you can also consider the case of the financial instrument, right? Then the expertise between the method of accounting of the financial instruments, how do you account for financial instrument, is the part of the auditor's internal expert. No doubt with that. And on the other hand, you have an expert who is involved in the complex modeling of the same financial instrument, for the valuation of the same financial instrument, will he also be considered an internal export? No, he is an external export. No internal person could have done this task, right? That is why it is an external export, right? So this is actually the straightforward distinction. You see the name, you see the purpose, you distinguish it. Now consider a situation where you have new accounting being developed. That means the account is not yet 100% recognized and not yet very developed. They are still in the process of developing accounting on that particular area. Now, if you are applying it, then the work of the export that you are using for that application, right, how to apply it, will that be considered an alternate export, external internal, is again a matter of doubt. Because there is no straight, clear, forward distinction based on which you can decide, hey, this is external. Hey, come on, you are internal. No, the jobs are similar now. Whom will you consider internal? Whom will you consider external? Because once he's external, he is basically an external. You'll deal with him like an external. But if he becomes internal, you'll deal with him like he's internal. Right? So there is a great deal depending upon it. So in such situation, you are required to use your professional judgment. You remember professional judgment, SA 200, ethical requirements, the last part, professional behavior. Then we did professional skepticism, professional judgment. Do you people remember that? Yes, then that is the professional judgment we are calling for over here. And again, remember one thing, when we are talking about professional judgment, right, it requires tools. And that tool is provided by the professional rules and the standard that is laid down for those accountants. Clear with that? Now, the other point that we were talking about, that he can be an individual or an organization. Even this is a matter to discuss, because over there your judgment would always also depend. Now, for example, if there was Mr. X, right? You are appointing Mr. X and you want to judge whether Mr. X is the right person to do that or whether his job has been performed well. What do you check? You check his current performance exactly, but you also check past experiences. Okay, in the past I've had an interaction with this person at maybe some other client and he worked out very well. That is easier for you to identify and rely upon his work. But on the other hand, if there was an organization involved, and you know that, okay, on my XYZ client also, I use this organization, then you will not be sure as to who was the personnel who was deployed. Over there, their organization, why they deployed Y1 and Y2. And over here, they were using X3, X4, X5, X6, and that made a difference. That can make a difference. Because X, who was earlier employed, as you can see, in the individual case, and he's again, you can depend upon his work. But over here, you have depended because the previous person, maybe Mr. Z1, Z2, who was engaged over here, worked very well, and Y1, Y2 did not work at all. Just because of the past experience that yes, earlier it was good, will you go for it? That is the question you need to ask. Hence, bifurcating the two will be very important, and using the two, whichever it is, in any form, it will always be useful for the manager or for the auditor. If it is an individual, then his personal attributes will be very important, because you know, he performed the task earlier very well, he will be able to do it very well this time too. But if it is an organization, right, then you'll have to see the managerial attributes of the organization, and hence both of it is very much relevant for you, because you have to abide by the standard, you have to go by the rules, and you have to prove yourself. The other definition after that is expertise. Expertise means skill, knowledge and experience in a particular field. Right? If in any particular field, you pick up any field over there, if you have knowledge for that field, if you have the skills to perform that task, and if you have experience in the past, then you turn out to be an expert. Last is the management expert. Over here, what you decide is an individual or organization possessing expertise in the fields other than accounting and auditing, whose work in that field is used by the entity to assist the entity in preparing the financial statement. That means again the same decision. So same example I'll take, right? That actuary, his work was used by the entity because at the time of preparing the financial statement, they wanted those figures to be inserted in the financial statement. And now if there is any change happening, then everything goes for a toss. Why? Because you never know where the error has occurred. So you'll have to check that. Instead of error, you basically have to see if that work of the same actuary was used, right? You will not employ the same actuary to check his own work, right? So basically, management expert, an individual or organization possessing expertise in the fields other than accounting and auditing. This is a very important term, other than accounting and auditing, whose work in the field is used by the entity to assist the entity in preparing the financial statement, right? So with that, we are done with the definitions in this standard, right? The three definitions, auditor's expert, expertise, and the management expert. Now it's time for us to move on to the requirement portion, right? And the first requirement which we have is determining the need of an auditor's expert. So the ground level rule that you need to understand while determining the need of an auditor's expert is that whether you need any consultation, whether you need any support in a field which is other than your accounting and auditing, right? If your financial statement or if the work of your audit requires you to evaluate or requires you to get into and understand or audit a particular assertion, right, for which a knowledge or expertise in a particular field that is apart from your auditing and accounting is needed, then that is the alarming situation, or that is the trigger point actually from where you decide, from where you get into that entire discussion with your team, that entire conceptual thinking behind it, and determine whether or not you need an expert, right? If you think that yes, you can handle it yourself, you can do it very well, you can go ahead with it, then go ahead, no problem with that. But if you consider that no, there is a problem and you will not be able to solve it, then it is suggested that you go for an auditor's expert. And then you will also need to determine whether the expert that you have involved, can you use his work after he has worked, right? You have to evaluate his work before you incorporate it into your working of the audit. So that is the baseline that we'll understand for determining the need of an auditor's expert. Now we get into the details. Now for this situation, just think of it, right? When we were discussing the SA300 series, right, and other procedures that we have already discussed, you know that when we start with the audit, the first thing we try to get used to is the entity, right? The first thing you do is you understand the entity, then you assess the risk, what is the risk associated to this entity, and how would you respond to those risks, what are the procedures you'll be performing, right, what are the evidences you will be attaining, and based on that, what decisions are you gonna make. So basically this is the process. So when we are talking about the auditor's expert, we cannot identify or we cannot define that yes, this is the only portion of the stage where you would need an expert. No. An expert could be needed at any point of time in your audit. At the beginning, at the end, while reporting, while forming an opinion, in the middle, during your procedures, anywhere, anytime, right? This is one thing you need to understand. The auditor may consider that yes, he needs an expert. For what? For number one, obtaining the understanding of the entity. But that is the first thing the auditor does. So even in that portion, when he needs to understand the entity, maybe it is in a different industry, different field, that the auditor has a little knowledge, right? For example, if we are into the oil segment and the auditor has a little knowledge about the oil, or we're into the mining, coal, mineral or stones, whatever it is. And if you think the auditor does not have, right? It depends on the auditor to auditor, from firm to firm, what kind of knowledge do they have, right? It also depends upon their past experiences in audit, right? Their associations, their qualifications, their other degrees that they have attained, right? The other field of expertise that they have. So it will always depend on auditor to auditor. It is not specific that yes, in this field you need an expert, in this field you do not need an expert. There may be an auditor who may need an expert in all the fields. There may be an auditor who may not need any expert at all. And there are others who may need it at different places in their audit, right? So maybe when you're understanding the audit, you would need an auditor. So take it then, right? After understanding the audit, when you go ahead to identify what is the risk associated to your audit, right? Even for that evaluation, you want an expert, go ahead, get an expert, right? Wherever you feel that yes, you need an expert, right? So it's always better that you employ an expert, pay him some money, rather than giving out a faulty disclaimer, right, in your report. If you do not issue a quality report, right, with true assertions, with true opinion, understanding everything, forming your correct opinion about it, if you do not give that, your audit process will actually not be of any help to anybody outside the entity. No users of financial statement will actually be able to rely on your report, right? So even for identifying the risk of material misstatement, you need an expert, right? And then how do you respond to that risk, right? What is the best alternative that you have to respond to that risk will also require the support of an expert, right? So he would determine that, okay, these are the things where, as per me, the expert would say that as per me, these are the areas for which these are the procedures you should follow, But if you go ahead with this direction, you will be able to tackle it very well and get an understanding. So he will also suggest you the procedure that you need to perform, and then you perform along with that expert such procedures. He is not here for consultancy, right? He will perform the procedures, he will give you the result, and then you will have to analyze and determine whether his work was appropriate, right? So he will tell you the procedures, he will go with the procedures, try to find out what is in it, what is not in it, right? And what are the risks over there, and what the entity has done. All the data will be evaluated, and then the expert reaches a conclusion that it forwards to the auditor, right? And whatever the evidences that the expert has attained, right, you will have to judge the sufficiency and appropriateness of that as well, checking the base data that has been sent to them, whether that was correct, whether that was accurate, because based on that data itself, the expert is going to perform his procedures. So there are a lot of things that you need to consider, and there are a lot of areas, a lot of spaces where you know that yes, you can fill in the gap by using the work of an expert. Correct with that? Now there's one more angle to through which you should look at these situations, right? Now for example, your management, right, the management of the company, they have involved experts in certain field. That happens normally. But you know, when we went for the audit, right, so what were we told initially to be skeptical about is when the management is actually involving some foreign elements, like someone outside the entity to perform some task for them. Like if they have to prepare the financial statement, but there are some data, some figures that they are not able to calculate with accuracy, right? Or they don't know the basis based on which they would calculate it. So they would require an expert. Again, I'll take the same example, the actuary, right? They don't know how to calculate the gratuity, the leave encashment things and all. Right, so what they do is they provide the data, the basic data on which these evaluations will be based, to the actuary, right? And what does the actuary does? The actuary performs all the calculations and sends them the final figure. Now you should understand that in situations where the management has used an expert, right, it is a clear indicator that the management does not possess any knowledge about that field. So what happens is that would increase your risk of material misstatement. Why? Because management gives you an assertion that yes, these data are correct. But how do you know? Because management, they themselves does not know. So if somebody comes to you and says, hey, look, this thing happened in the world, and he himself does not know anything about it, and he goes on to explain, you are, this is it, that has happened, and this is how we tackled it and everything. And you say, what? Dude, did you do anything in that? Do you have any proper knowledge about that? If you go on questioning that person, the person goes blank. So how do you trust that person? Or how would you say that, okay, the risk is still moderate and we'll go ahead with it? No, you would not. Because in these situations, they give you an indication that there is a risk of material misstatement. Right? And when you understand that there is a risk of material misstatement, you go on to evaluate it. And if that is a field, if the management has no knowledge about it, and even you do not have a knowledge, any knowledge about it, because it is out of your purview of auditing and accounting, right? But still, you understand that there is a risk. So even you need to involve an expert in such situation. That okay, there's something the management does not know, but the management has provided it to me, and even I do not know anything about that, speaking very true to it, right? So what you do is you need an expert who would give you the basis of calculation, who would give you some views, who would throw some light upon the topic, and then let you know what is right and what is wrong. So that is again one more angle with which you determine basically the need of an auditor's expert. And when you involve an expert in that situation, you would determine his competency, his capability, his objectivity and everything, right? And what will that expert do for you is basically that the expert would help you in determining the nature, time and extent of the procedures that you need to perform. And the auditor also needs to determine the work of the expert, and also that to what extent would that work or that result of the expert would assist the auditor in meeting the requirements that was defined. And this decision of using the work of an expert may fluctuate with the progress of your audit, which means to say that yes, when you came here for the audit and you found out that yeah, these are the areas we need to audit, and you think yeah, there are some areas for which you would require an expert, right? But when you go on and you see that okay, although that area was determined, although that area was defined in the financial statement, but you do not have a lot of work to do over there, right? That was a very basic and a very little amount involved, so that was not material although, and that the only basic was needed to audit that particular area, and you had some knowledge about it and you had some past experience, and you think, okay, you will be able to do it. There's no requirement of an expert. There's no need to get into the details of analysis of anything else, because the management did not use it to that extent. So your determination of the use of the work of an auditor's expert would shift from time to time. Clear with that? And with this, the last thing that you need to understand is when and when not the auditor would need an expert, right? So basically, suppose there is a field, right, which is apart from your auditing and accounting, right, where a little expertise in that field is also needed, right? But it is not necessary that the auditor would require an expert over there. Why? Because maybe the auditor has some past experience, right, of dealing with such situation or dealing with such assertions, right? He already has an experience of auditing those entities where he had to deal with certain situations. Maybe he used an expert then, but now he knows how to deal with such situation. Secondly, maybe he has some other qualifications as well along with his CA, right? If he is a cost and work accountant as well, he could do the valuation. If he is an actuary as well, he could do the actuarial calculations as well, right? So it depends on what the auditor's professional competence is, apart from auditing and accounting. So if there's something like that, he could also go ahead with himself doing the work of an expert instead of hiring an expert for that purpose, right? Second, if he would last, sorry, it's not second, the third point, if the auditor would get in touch with other auditors who have performed engagements on the specific area where he's facing the difficulties, and they would guide him as to how to do, right? So being an auditor, you could just approach the other auditors, maybe in the same firm or maybe in a different firm, right, and take guidance as to how to deal with such situation. And if you're able to do it by yourself, you do not need an expert for that. Okay with that? Right, so that was it about determining the need of an auditor's expert, right? That is all which is relevant for you to understand, right? Next requirement we have is the nature, time and extent of the audit procedures. So when we need to judge the nature, time and extent of the audit procedures, right, what are the things that we need to consider, right? What are the matters that needs to be considered for determining the nature, time and extent of the audit procedure, right? So first we'll have to determine the nature of the matter to which the auditor's expert's work relate. That means the matter that you consider that, okay, this is beyond auditing and accounting and I need an expert, right? So what is the nature of that matter? That is important to determine the nature of the procedure that you will perform on that. And then you will also determine what is the associated risk of material misstatement in that particular matter, right? And if you involve an expert, then what is the significance of his work, right? Where will you use his work in your audit? Is his work significant for your audit purpose? Is it solving the purpose for which you have involved the expert, right? And for this, what will the auditor check? Whether or not they had any previous interaction with this expert, right? Has he used the work of this expert earlier? Then what was the result of it? Was he convinced with it? Was there a discrepancy over there? So all these things need to be considered, right? And also that the auditor is following the quality control policies and the procedures that the auditor has established. And if all these things are going well, we would consider the work to be appropriate, and accordingly we will determine our nature, time and extent for the audit procedures. Now, when we talk about whether the expert is subject to the auditor firm's quality control policies and procedure, what do you mean by that, right? You have to evaluate whether the expert that you have involved, right, whether your firm's, right, the quality control policies of your individual firm, the audit firm, will that be applicable on that expert? That means what has been determined and what has been discussed in SQC1, will that be relevant for that expert as well? So there are situations for that, right? Now, for example, the expert that you have involved is an internal expert. That means he is a partner or maybe a staff of the audit team or the audit firm, right, that is involved in the audit of this entity, right? So if he is a staff of the same audit firm, then he is subject to those quality control procedures. Otherwise also, if he is a partner or a staff of any network firm, right, and that network firm which shares the common quality control procedures, if it is such situation, then again your firm's quality control procedure will be applicable on him. Now, third situation, now if he is an external expert, right, that you have hired from the market, you went to him and you requested him to perform the task for you, right? You have appointed him for that particular task. And then certain law and regulation may also require at times that if you involve an expert, or if that expert is involved for that specific field or task, then he may abide by the quality control procedure that you have set forth for your entity. If that is the situation, then again your quality control procedures and policies will be applicable on that auditor and on that expert. So when we're talking about the applicability of the firm's quality control procedure, these are the situations when it would be applicable on the expert. Clear with that? Now, how do you basically determine what would be the nature, what would be the timing, and what would be the extent to which you have to perform the audit procedure, right? When you come to the expert, or when you are dealing with the expert. So like we discussed about the management expert in SA 500, similarly we would also evaluate the competency, capability and objectivity of the expert that you are involving over here. Objectivity although will not play a very important role, because he is ought to be independent, right? He's not involved by the management, he's involved by you. So basically two assertions that you will still be checking is the competency and the capability. Competency, again, if I remind you, it is about the qualification, about the expertise that he possesses, and capability is about using that knowledge and his professional qualification in performing the task that is required out of him, right? And when we talk about the objectivity, yes, that expert is also subject to the relevant ethical requirement, and the most important ethical requirement, as we have always discussed, is the independence. Right, so we'll see whether that auditor's expert is independent or not, because maybe, okay, we are hiring that person, right, but at one point of time you can still get into the situation and realize and find that yes, this expert is already connected to the entity. Maybe it has given some services in the past due to which they have good relationships now. Maybe he holds some shares, maybe there's any kind of relationship, right? So that would impact the objectivity of the expert. So you will also have to consider that as a factor. Then your evaluation of the adequacy of his work, even that will be an impact. Now consider a situation where the expert is an internal expert, right? Then you must have certain training programs in your firm, right? That is provided to all the personnel of the firm, right? So if you have a good reliance on those training programs, that yes, our procedures, our programs, our grooming about the individual in our firm is good and it's appropriate, then you would determine that, okay, if I am involving an expert from within the entity, right, forget about what his qualification is, forget about what other things are, his capabilities are, but if we have already trained him with, or we have taken him through certain training programs in our firm, and we know that those training programs are effective, then we can still rely on the expert that, okay, at least this is what he should be doing, right? So that would reduce your NTE, nature, timing and extent. But if you think that we ourselves, we do not trust the training, or the expert has not been through the training or something, then your nature, time and extent would increase. And then your nature, time and extent would also depend upon the regulatory and the legal requirements. Even that is something you need to consider, right? And finally, what agreement you are entering into with that expert. We did not talk about agreement so far in the standard, neither this nor in SA 500 with the management expert. But yeah, remember, when you are appointing the auditor's expert, there is an engagement, right? You decide as to what are the tasks he needs to perform, what are the things he needs to do, what is your responsibility, what is his responsibility. All these things will also be determined and noted down in the agreement that you have with the external expert. So these are the two things that we have discussed from the requirement, and the rest of the things, that is the competence, capability, objectivity of the auditor's expert, obtaining an understanding of the field of the expertise of the auditor's expert, agreement with the auditor's expert, and evaluating the adequacy of the auditor's expert work. These are the four more requirements that are still pending and still to go. So we'll take them up in the next lecture, right? So we'll end our lecture over here with defining and understanding the two specific requirements, that is determining the need of an auditor's expert and the nature, timing and extent of the audit procedure, right? So with this, I'm Abhinay Gupta. I'll be signing off from this lecture today. Please stay tuned for the next upcoming lecture. Until then, thank you.